Let's go to 531 in your hymnal, 531. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Let's all stand together as we sing. 531 together. On that first.
All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Ye chosen seed of Israel, drink ye ransomed from the fall.
Good singing and good to see you here this morning, and welcome to Sunday morning service, and great, beautiful morning this morning, and looking forward to what the Lord has in store for us today. Thanks for being in church on a holiday weekend. Amen. And good singing this morning. Let's bow for prayer together, shall we? Father, we bow before you in prayer today. Thank you for another beautiful morning that you've blessed us with. Thank you for the privilege and opportunity for us to gather together here in this place. And Father, we bow here at the beginning of the service that we would ask that you would be lifted up in the service today, that we would be able to focus on you this morning and what you would want to do in each one of our hearts and lives. Father, I do ask you, if any in the room today have never come to know Christ as their Savior, that today would be the day that they'd come to know him as their personal Savior. Lord, any today that are away from you, that you would draw them back to you today. And I pray, God, you'd minister to our hearts and meet the needs of the people in this room as only you can. And Lord, we'll thank you for it. Now control the service and direct it, please. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, you may be seated.
Sin and despair, till Jesus in love sought and rescued me there. He saved me from wandering, he gave me release, and led me to pathways of blessing and peace. And shall I turn back into the world? Oh, no, not I, not I. And shall I turn back into the world? No, no, not I. Mighty, swiftly passing, have brought from above so many bright tokens of mercy and love. More grace he has given and burdens removed. Yes, over and over his goodness I proved. How well I remember in sorrow's dark night the lamp of his word shed its beautiful light, and sweet was the voice of the Comforter then, and waking new praises again and again. And shall I turn back into the world? Oh, no, not I, not I. And shall I turn back into the world? No, no, not I. Before me my joys of eternity rise. Each day I am nearing my home in the skies. My Savior a mansion has gone to prepare, and loved ones are waiting to welcome me there. And shall I turn back into the world? Oh, no, not I, not I. And shall I turn back into the world? No, no, not I. And shall I turn back into the world? Oh, no, not I, not I. And shall I turn back into the world? No.
Let's go to number 50 in your hymnal, 50. Would you be free from the burden of sin? There's power, wonder-working power in the blood. On that verse together.
Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you for evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood.
Listen carefully now, a few announcements for us. Regular schedule today, we have 5:30 Christian Growth Class meets down in the conference room. And tonight's subject is going to be on heaven. Heaven. Heaven's a real place. It's a prepared place, and it's for a prepared people. And we're going to learn a little bit about heaven this evening in the 5:30 Christian Growth Class. And so you're encouraged to attend that if you like. That's at 5:30. Then 6:30, we'll be right back in here for the evening service. And the evening service tonight, Lord willing, I'm going to speak on the subject, the church and the world. The church and the world. And what's the relationship there? What's the what should be happening with the church and the world? I think it'll be a help to you this evening. Be back in church on Sunday night. And then, reminder, today's the day you're to get all the missionary gifts in from the cards that you took from the table. If that's not going to happen, just see the ladies and let them know when you'll have those gifts to them. And they can prepare that. They'll be beginning this week to get all those ready for the missionaries. It's coming up quickly, and so that'll be here soon. The other thing to let you know is this week carpeting will be here, and Lord willing, on Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, this auditorium will get recarpeted. Okay, and from that point forward, there will be no food or drink allowed in the auditorium. Okay, brand new carpeting and everything, so no food or drink anymore in here. We'll take care of what the Lord's given to us and keep it nice, and I think it's gonna. You look real good by next Sunday, all right? And appreciate you cooperating with that. All right. I think that's all I've got right now. We'll take just a moment. Welcome any guests we have with us today. Anybody here today visiting for the first time? Not a member here at Bible Baptist Church? Roy back there, and Roy Hall, right? And from the West Side, good to have him here. I mean, he was in our Sunday school this morning, and glad he's here in the church service as well. All right. Autumn, good to see you this morning. Good. Mom and Dad doing good? Great, great. Tell them hello from us, okay? That's wonderful. And anyone else? All right. Let's give Roy a warm welcome, shall we?
Two six four. He is able to deliver thee. 'Tis the grandest theme through the ages rung. He is able to deliver thee. Let's sing that first together. 'Tis the grandest theme o'er the ages rung. 'Tis the grandest theme for a mortal tongue. 'Tis the grandest theme that the world e'er sung. Our God is able to deliver thee. He is able to deliver thee. He is able to deliver thee. Though by sin oppressed, go to him for rest. Our God is able to deliver thee. 'Tis the grandest theme in the earth or main. 'Tis the grandest theme for a mortal strain. 'Tis the grandest theme. Tell the world. Children, why don't you go on out to junior church right now. Children, you're dismissed to junior church as we sing the last together. 'Tis the grandest theme, let the tidings roll to the guilty heart. The That's great. Would you go with me to 241? 241, grace that is greater than all our sin. Let's all stand together as we sing. Marvelous grace of our loving Lord. On that verse together.
Marvelous grace of our loving Lord. Grace that exceeds our sin and our guilt. Thunder on Calvary's mount outpoured. There where the blood of the Lamb was spilled. Grace, grace, God's grace. Grace that will pardon and cleanse within.
Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. Thank you. that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Marvelous, infinite, matchless grace. Let's sing that last together. Marvelous, infinite, matchless grace, freely bestowed on all who believe. You that are looking to see His face, will you this moment His grace receive? Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse with.
Seated. Ushers will come and get our offering now this morning. Be prepared to give as God has blessed and prospered you through another week. And we'll pray and we'll ask God's blessing on our giving this morning. Brother Polabel, lead us in our prayer, please.
Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day that you've given us. Thank you for this church that you've raised up here and pastor that you brought here, and we pray that you'd bless him today and may the spirit of God work through him. And we ask that you'd bless those that give this morning, and if there's one here that does not know you as Lord and Savior, that today would be the day that they come to know you as Lord and Savior. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please take your Bible this morning for our scripture reading. Matthew 14, please. Matthew chapter 14. Matthew 14. We'll begin reading with verse number 15 and read through verse number 21. Read the verses responsively, begin together on 15, and I'll read 16 and alternate like that till we end on verse 21. And as our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing, please, to read God's word. And let's begin together on verse 15 of Matthew chapter 14. Ready? And when it was evening, his disciples came to him, saying, "This is a desert place, and the time is now past. Send the multitude away, that they may go into the villages and buy themselves victuals." But Jesus said unto them, "They need not depart. Give ye them to eat." And they say unto him, "We have here but 5 loaves and 2 fishes. He said, "Bring them hither to me." And he commanded the multitude to sit down on the grass, and took the 5 loaves and the 2 fishes, and looking up to heaven, he blessed and brake, and gave the loaves to his disciples, and the disciples to the multitude. And they did all eat and were filled. And they took up of the fragments that remained 12 baskets full. And they that had eaten were about 5,000 men beside women and children. And let's pray together. Father, add your blessing, please, to the reading of the scripture here this morning. I pray, God, that you would prepare our hearts for the preaching of your word today. Thank you for the music this morning and for the good spirit that's here today. And Father, we pray that each of our hearts would become good ground that the word of God could fall into and bring forth fruit in our lives today. Lord, I pray your blessing on the special now. In Jesus' name, amen.
God never moves without purpose or plan when trying his servant and molding a man. Give thanks to the Lord, though your testing seems long. In darkness he giveth a song. Oh, rejoice in the Lord, he makes no mistake. He knoweth the end of each path that I take. For when I am tried and purified, I shall come forth as gold. I could not see through the shadows ahead, so I looked at the cross of my Savior instead. I bowed to the will of the Master that day. Then peace came and tears fled away. Oh, rejoice in the Lord, he makes no mistake. He knoweth the end of each path that I take. For when I am tried and purified, I shall come forth as gold. Now I can see testing comes from the Lord. God strengthens his children and purges in love. My Father knows best, and I trust in his care. Through purging, more fruit I will bear. Oh, rejoice in the Lord, he makes no mistake. He knoweth the end of each path that I take. For when I am tried and purified, I shall come forth as gold.
Amen. Now, Father, we bow before you in prayer this morning. We thank you, Lord, for again the privilege to come together and open up your word this morning. Father, we desire that you speak to each one of us through your inspired word today. We believe the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than a two-edged sword. And Father, I pray that you would help us this morning to focus and give our full attention to your word. Lord, I pray that you'd keep us from distractions, keep our minds from wandering to where we'd miss what you would want us to hear this morning. We're here, we're in the service. We ought to hear what God wants to tell us today. And so help me as I bring the truth today and help the folks as they listen. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Amen. If you're more comfortable going back with him, you can. Okay? That's up to you. If you just, you know what I mean? If he's going to, I realize he's in here for a reason. So just so you're fine. I'm fine with that if you want to, so don't worry about that. Pastor, we're struggling to serve God. It's been tough. I just lost my job. The kids have been sick. We're behind on our bills. The pressure is causing some problems at home. Pastor, what's going on? I never seem to have had it this hard before I got saved. Or, Pastor, I know I'm saved, but I sure do struggle with my past. I'm not sure I went through what I went through, the abuse or the divorce or the sin that was around me, but I just don't understand why I still struggle with that every day. I want to help you this morning, as I tried to help those folks, with this truth that I want to share with you today, and that is, God breaks before He uses. God breaks before He uses. Two people both want to be used by God, and by the way, that ought to be the desire of every believer, to be used by God, to that God would use our life for His service and for His glory. When you read the Bible and you read about men in the Bible, from Abraham to Moses to Joseph to Gideon to Elijah, on into the New Testament to Peter or Paul, boy, there just ought to be something inside of you as a Christian to say, God, would you use my life too? Would you do something with my life that'll count for eternity? Matthew 14, where we read this morning, is a very familiar story to most people who've been in church. It's called the feeding of the 5,000. Now, there were more than that, because the Bible says it was just 5,000 men besides the women and the children. So it easily could have been 10,000 to 15,000 that were fed that day by Jesus, who was given just 5 loaves and 2 fishes and multiplied those. And notice what it says in verse 19. He commanded the multitude to sit down on the grass, and took the 5 loaves and the 2 fishes, and looking up to heaven, He blessed and broke and gave the loaves to His disciples, and the disciples gave them to the multitude. Notice that He prayed, that's the blessing, and then He broke it. And then He gave it to disciples, and then they used it to be a blessing to the multitude. We like to beg God to use us, but very rarely does anybody say, God, break me. Break me, that You might use me. Let's consider some people in the Bible this morning, shall we? Let's think about Joseph. Joseph had big dreams. And whether it was right or not to tell it to his brothers, well, you'll have to be the own judge of that. But they didn't receive it too well. He had a dream, and by the way, the dream was from God. It was reality. It was going to happen. But his brothers didn't appreciate it, and when he went out to check on his brothers, they turned on him. And they eventually decided they were going to throw him in a pit, and really they were going to leave him there for the wild animals to get. In those days, the men to catch wild animals would dig a pit, and in the bottom of the pit they would put very sharp objects sticking up, so when the animal falls in, he would impale himself and die, and then they could come and just get the animal out of the pit. They threw Joseph in the pit, expecting just to leave him there till some wild animal devoured him. They took his coat, you remember, and they put blood on it, animal blood on it, and they're going to lie to Dad. And they didn't leave him in the pit. Some slave traders came along, Midianites heading toward Egypt, and they sold him as a slave. Hey, dreamer, how's this work out with your dream? You know the story. He goes down into Egypt. He gets a good job. He's a good worker, working for a man named Potiphar. Potiphar's wife lays eyes on him and decides she's going after him. And one day when they're all alone in the house, she makes her move on him, and Joseph says, I can't do this and sin against God. And he ran out of the house, and she grabbed his coat, kept it. Of course, when she started screaming and people came running in, and she goes, that Hebrew boy, he tried to attack me, and I just grabbed his coat when he ran away when I started screaming. Who are you going to believe, Potiphar's wife or a slave boy? Huh? He's put in prison. I want you to look at a scripture with me in Psalm 105, will you please? The 105th Psalm. Psalm 105. Joseph's dream was that everybody was bowing down to him, that he was the ruler, and everybody was a servant to him. That didn't sit well with his older brothers. The Bible says in 105, Psalm 105, verse number 17, here he says, he sent a man before them, even who, church? Joseph, who was sold for a servant, whose feet they hurt with fetters. He was laid in iron until the time that his word came, that the word of the Lord tried him. So Joseph gets down into Egypt, and of course they believe Potiphar's wife, and he's cast into prison. And we know from this scripture, they put him in irons. They was in fetters, and we know it hurt. Because the Bible says it hurt him. It hurt his feet. And so we understand, what was God doing? Well, the Bible says the word of the Lord was trying him. You know what he really was doing? I believe he was breaking Joseph. What's he breaking Joseph of? Any pride? Let me tell you what God's going to do with me. If God's going to do something with you, let God do something with you. Don't tell everybody what God's going to do with you. That's pride. He's breaking Joseph of pride. He's breaking Joseph of self-confidence. Listen, he's going to break Joseph of any bitterness or revenge. The breaking process has to come before he can use him. Once Joseph is broken. And listen, I believe the selling of his brothers, the time in the pit, the time with those slave traders, the time in Potiphar's house, the time in prison, God was using that process to break Joseph so he could bless him and use him. The time came, he got out of the prison and was exalted to second in command behind Pharaoh. And really, Pharaoh yielded to Joseph and said, you make all the calls. And for 7 years of plenty, they stored up the grain and stored up all the food. And then when the 7 years of famine come, Joseph dished it out. You know the story. We'll come back to that a little bit when his brothers came. But God used Joseph greatly. And we think of good things when we hear the name of Joseph. But I want to remind you that God broke before he used. Another man I want you to consider this morning is a man named Moses. Moses really had a miraculous birth. He was born at a time when they were killing all the male babies. But his wife hid the pregnancy and hid the birth and actually put him in an ark, made a bull run, put him down in the bulrushes in the Nile there to hide him from those who'd become searching for the baby. And as God would have it, he had Pharaoh's daughter come down to bathe there in the Nile, and she hears the baby crying. And she doesn't tell the guards, go, there's a Hebrew baby, take him and kill him. God touches her heart. She has compassion on this one, and she takes him in as her own. In fact, she goes, you know what? Find one of the Hebrew women to nurse this child, and guess who they find? Moses' mother. Huh? Isn't God good? I mean, that's pretty miraculous that all that took place. And Moses, as he grows up in Pharaoh's house, though still in contact with his parents, I'm sure he was told what a gift from God he was and how God has protected him and God has plans for his life. There had to be some teaching in him, because the Bible says in Hebrews that it came time that he chose to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. That he took the reproaches of the people of Christ of greater riches than all that Egypt had. And he was Pharaoh's son, the daughter of Pharaoh, his son. He would have been a Pharaoh. He would have been number one in the land. He had the best of everything. And one day, a Hebrew and Egyptian are fighting with each other, and Moses settled the thing. You know what he did? Killed the Egyptian. Buried him in the sand. I'm sure Moses thought, okay, God's got his hand on me, and I'm going to deliver my people out of the oppression of these Egyptians, and if I got to do it one by one, bless God, I'll do it one by one. But next day, two Hebrews are arguing. When Moses tries to intervene to bring peace, they say, yeah, what are you going to do to me? Kill me like you did that Egyptian yesterday? Boy, now the word's out. Moses runs. He goes all the way to what's called the backside of the desert. The desert's bad enough. I'm not sure what the backside of the desert is. It's a pretty desolate place. And when he gets to the backside there, he meets a family and he falls in love with the daughter and he marries her and he goes to work for his father-in-law. I'm sure that was an experience. We'll find out more about that when we get to heaven. How many of you men here that are married, it would have been your life's dream to work for your father-in-law? Hold on, I'll wait while I wait for your hands to come up. That's what I thought. That's what he did. Hey, for 40 years, what was God doing? Breaking Moses. From being in the palace, from having all the luxuries of Egypt, from having the finest education, the finest of any that life could offer at the time, to being on the backside of the desert where nobody knows where you are, tending sheep. Do you remember when Israel went down into Egypt and Joseph brought his family in? Remember what he told them to tell them they were? Sheep herders. They were tenders of the sheep. You know why? That's an abomination in the sight of the Egyptians. So Moses now doing something that he was taught growing up was an abomination. It's a despised occupation. There he is. But God's breaking him. Because he wants to use him. But he couldn't use him until he's broken. He sees the bush burning one day. And apparently, not an uncommon sight on the backside of the desert with the heat. Bushes would burn, but they would consume. The difference with this bush was it was on fire and it wasn't being consumed. And so he stopped to watch this phenomenon. He was surprised. And then he found out it wasn't just not a consuming bush, it was a talking bush. And the bush started talking to him. And it was God. Take off your shoes, you're on holy ground. And of course, when God tells him, now I want you to go back and I want you to deliver my people Israel, you're going to go to Pharaoh and say, let my people go. Moses says, who, me? Not me. And you know the story from Exodus 3. He made excuses, remember? I can't talk. I'm not eloquent. I don't have the ability. He made all kinds of reasons why he couldn't go and why he couldn't do the job. And I think God said, Moses, that's exactly where I wanted you to get. What happened? What happened to the pride he had? What happened to the self-confidence he had before? What happened to that cockiness that he carried with him when he grew up in Pharaoh's house? All that's gone now. And God is ready to use him because Moses is finally broken and will listen to what God says to do. And by the way, he did lead Israel out. And when it came time for Moses to die, God gave him a private burial. Only God and him know where he was buried. Pretty amazing. Then I want you to think of another example this morning. A fellow named Gideon. You read about Gideon in the book of Judges. Gideon was chosen by God to fight a group called the Midianites. Now Gideon wasn't proud, but he wasn't broken. And when God came to him, he was fearful. Remember when he came, he was threshing his wheat or his corn there at night. You know why? He was afraid of the Midianites finding him. So he was doing it under the cover of darkness. All of Israel was afraid. They'd been overtaken by these Midianites. You see, fear never fights. Fear always pulls back. Faith will always push ahead. When Livingston in Africa said, "I'm willing to go any direction provided it be forward," that's faith. That's faith. So God has to break Gideon of fear and move him to faith. You remember the story? He gets calls for the army and 32,000 guys show up. Now, that's not bad. The Midianites had much more than that, but 32,000, I think we can work with this. Until God says, "Okay, Gideon, make the announcement, whoever is a fearful and afraid, they can go home." And I'm sure as Gideon made the announcement, he probably wanted to leave too. But he knew he couldn't. But when he made the announcement, "Oh, you're fearful, everybody's afraid, hey, go on home," he just about got run over in the stampede. 22,000 of the 32,000 left. Now, whatever fear may have gone when he thought he had 32,000, I think it started to grow back again when he realized I'm down to 10. But he thought, you know what, I still got 10,000. That's a pretty formidable army. I could do something with 10,000. And then God talks to him again and says, "You still have too many." I'm sure Gideon thought, "You've got to be kidding me." So God said, "Here's what I want you to do. Send them down to the lake there and have them get a drink of water. And if they just go into the water and just drink it up," he said, "you set them aside. They're not going to be in the army. But if they get on one knee and they lap it up and they keep watching for the enemy, those are the guys you want." Huh. Guess what? Only 300 went like that. 9,700 guys just dove into the water and started and didn't have any regard to who's around them or what's around them. So now he's got 300 to go against. The Bible doesn't give a number of the Midianites. It said they covered the ground like grasshoppers. Just so thick and so out, they couldn't even number them. And now Gideon has his measly 300. Well, remember what God's doing? I'm breaking you from fear to faith. What's it going to take to fight thousands, tens of thousands, maybe 100,000 with 300 guys? It's going to take faith. Faith in God. You know the story. He made them into three companies, 100 guys each, and he gave them their weapons, a pitcher and a trumpet. Said, "That's it. Wait a minute, we don't even get a sword?" No. God gave him a great victory over the Midianites when they just broke the trumpets and yelled, "The sword of the Lord and of Gideon." God brought the confusion among the Midianites and they started killing each other. God wrought a great victory that day and God used Gideon in a great way. They won the war, they won that battle without firing a shot. Absolute faith and trust in God. What a transformation for Gideon. But God broke before he used. Let me consider another fellow in the Old Testament. A fellow named Saul, first king of Israel. Saul was chosen for one reason. Who remembers what it was? Yeah. He was head and shoulders above everybody else. He was chosen just because he was big. Intimidating. He was chosen, if you take the Bible terminology, just because of his outward appearance. That's the guy we want. And at first, he didn't want the job. But once he got the job, the bad news is, went to his head. He became very proud. So much so, after the battle of the Philistines, when they were all afraid to fight this giant named Goliath, the little shepherd boy David came out with no armor and a sling and five smooth stones that he only needed one. And he defeated Goliath, and they came back from that victory and they were all singing a song. Saul has slain his, but David his tens of thousands. And Saul got jealous. Oh, he got angry. What's that? Pride. Whenever you get upset that someone else gets recognition and you don't, it's an indication you've got pride in your life. Saul was proud and he got angry, got jealous. In fact, when they were at another battle with heading for the Amalekites, you remember, where he didn't fully obey God, he's waiting for Samuel to come to do the sacrifice. Samuel doesn't get there when he's supposed to be there. He got detained by something. So Saul says, okay, I'll do the sacrifice. Who do you think you are, Saul? You're king, but you're not priest. You have not been anointed to the office of the priest. The priest was the one who represented the people before God. That was Samuel's position. That was chosen by God. You don't appoint yourself to that position. God appoints you to that position. When Samuel got there, he let Saul know, because of what you've done, God's taken the kingdom away from you. And Saul, you check it out, the rest of his life, just bitter, revengeful, unhappy, moody. Why? He wouldn't be broken. He refused to be broken. Now, I want news for you. I want to tell you something this morning. We are proud creatures. I don't care who you are in the room today. You're a human being. You have pride issues. It comes with something called the human nature. We come by it naturally, and the truth is, we come by it by our Father. Will you look at a verse of Scripture with me in John chapter 8? Or if you're in Matthew, maybe you're still in Psalms. Look at John chapter 8. John chapter 8. Are you okay? All right. John chapter 8. Doesn't matter if you're okay or not, I'm still going to preach, okay? Just thought I'd be nice to you. John 8, verse 44. Here's Jesus speaking to some religious people. Notice verse number 44. He says, ye are of your father. Who, church? Who, church? And the lusts of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. Pride. Where we get our pride? I get it from my father. Prior to knowing Jesus Christ as my Savior and being adopted into the family of God and God becoming my father, my father was the devil. I got news for you. So was yours. That's why there's a struggle with pride. You know, the first sin that there ever was pride. It came from Lucifer, the devil himself. Lying comes from the devil himself. receive those things from Him. And the devil is a proud creature. The Bible says God resists the proud, but He gives grace to the humble. All that is in the world, the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. Turn over to the book of Psalms, would you please? Psalms. Pick up Psalm 34 and then Psalm 51. Psalm 34 and then Psalm 51, if you would. Psalm 34, notice with me, verse number 18. The Lord is nigh unto them that are of a broken heart, and saveth such as be of a contrite spirit. You say, oh, I just want to be close to God. Do you know what you're asking? You're asking God to break your heart. He's nigh to those that have a broken heart. Psalm 51, David's prayer after he had sinned against God. Verse 17, the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart, O God, Thou wilt not despise. You say, well, Pastor, it just seems like I'm battling like never before. I don't understand what's going on. Can I help you? God may be breaking you. He's breaking you because He desires to bless you and use you. But He cannot do that if you're not willing to be broken. As long as we look at God and say, why are you doing this to me? Why is this happening to me? Why me, God? Instead of saying, God, if you're breaking me that you can use me, then break me. Because I want to be used by you. I'm going to give you three statements and then we'll be done. Number one is this, broken people are tender-hearted people. Broken people are tender-hearted people. Moses and Joshua come down from the mountain. They receive the commandments of the Lord. And they hear noise in the camp. What's gone on is the people thought he's been gone too long. And they go to Aaron and say, make us a God that we can worship. We don't know what's happened to this Moses guy. And Aaron takes all the gold and stuff they got from Egypt and he fashions it into a golden calf. And Moses comes down and of course he's angry and he throws the commandments down and they break. Might as well, they already broke them. But wait a minute. Moses prays for those people. You read Exodus 32 and Moses is interceding for those people because God says, I'll just start over. Just stand back. I'll wipe them all out. I'm sick of these people. Moses prays and when he prays in Exodus 32 for his people, he says, and Lord, if you won't forgive them, he says, then blot my name. And there's a line there where it's indicative that as he's praying, Moses just broke down, weeping for these disobedient people. Moses had a tender heart. Where'd he get that? When God broke him. When God broke him. He had a tender heart. How about Joseph? When finally his brothers revealed himself, there were times Joseph had to leave the room and do what? Weep. His heart was tender. His brothers, after dad was dead, were for sure, well, now he's going to want revenge. And Joseph still said, fellas, I've forgiven you. That's a tender heart. Tears, listen, Tears come easily to broken people. Tears come easily to broken people. But they also have the joy of knowing that God's going to bless them and God's going to use them. Let me give you statement number two. Broken people cannot get offended. Broken people cannot get offended. Genesis chapter 50. Would you turn there for a minute? Genesis chapter 50. This again goes back to Joseph when his brothers come to him after dad has died. And they come to lie again to Joseph. Joseph, dad said before he died that you're supposed to forgive us. Now, he said, make sure Joseph doesn't retaliate. Now, I don't know. It's not recorded. I say they lie. It's not recorded that Jacob said that. But I highly doubt that he did. But they were afraid for themselves. They thought Joseph would only not take in revenge because dad was still alive. And now that he's out of the picture, he's going to let him have it. And you know the great verse, Genesis 50 and verse 20. It's the Romans 8:28 of the Old Testament. Genesis 50, 20. But as for you, Joseph said, you thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good to bring to pass as it is this day to save much people alive. And so you look at it and said, Joseph said, man, you thought it was evil, but God meant it for good. He said, I've learned something. God is in control of my life. God is in control of my life. God is in control of my life. I'm not. God controls that. You don't get verse 20 without getting verse 19. Verse 19, Joseph said unto them, that's his brothers, fear not, for am I in the place of God? You know when you can't say you meant it for evil, but God meant it for good? When you are taking the place of God. Well, they shouldn't talk to me that way. Well, he shouldn't have said that to me. Well, he shouldn't use that. Well, wait a minute. Are you in the place of God? Do you want to learn what God wants you to learn? Even remember a few weeks ago when Shimei and David left at the insurrection of Absalom and Shimei come out cursing him? Abishai and Joab says, hey, we'll take his head off. He said, oh, you guys leave him alone. God may send him just to do this. Maybe God wants him to throw these curses at me. Maybe that's what I need. But all I know is this, God's in control of my life. And while that may be evil and someone may mean it for evil and they may have said some hurtful things, you know what? God may mean it for my good. So I'll take it as from the Lord. Who am I to determine what's good or what's bad? God, that's God's department. I can tell you don't understand that. You're looking at me like, what? Hey, the devil's lie in the Garden of Eden was, hey, you eat of this tree and you'll determine what's good and evil. Up to that point, Adam and Eve never considered it. Why? That's God's department. And it's still God's department. But ever since we took of that fruit and we ate of the tree, man has thought, I'm going to decide what's good and evil. And though we get saved, and though we receive Christ our Savior, we live our lives judging whether what just happened is good or whether it's bad. Instead of saying, God, whatever you want. That God never moves without purpose or plan when molding His servant and shaping a man. There's always a reason behind that. That God is using in your life and my life. So why would I get offended? If I get offended, I'm really mad at God. If a person says something to me they shouldn't say or does something to me they shouldn't do, who allowed that to happen? So why would I get angry unless I'm angry at God? We get angry because I can't control that. You find out, have you lived long enough to know you can't control other people? In fact, have you lived long enough to find out you can't even control yourself? That you need God's help? Broken people cannot get offended. Broken people are tender-hearted people. Number three, broken people are used by God. It's only after God broke Joseph that he used him. It's only after God broke Moses that he used him. It's only after God broke Gideon that he used him. It's only after God broke David that he used him. And only after God broke Peter that Peter could be used. So I want to be a blessing to others. I want God to use me. And you ought to want that. But then you must be willing to say, God, break me. Break me. Are you willing to be broken? Why the trouble? Why the burdens? Why the heartache? Why the difficulties? Why the criticism? Why the illness? It just might be that God's breaking you. And the good news is, God breaks before He uses. And God may just be getting ready to use you in a great way. It's a whole lot easier to take the breaking if you know it's leading to God using you. It doesn't matter who you pick out of Christian leaders who you look up to or admire. If you look at someone and you say they're just doing a great work for God, I guarantee you, you go into their life, there's a time when they were broken before God. Little chorus we used to sing. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Break me, melt me, mold me, use me. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. That's what it takes. Are you willing to let God break you, melt you, mold you, and then use you? God always breaks before He uses. Heavenly Father, take the truth now this morning. Thank You for the attention of everyone today. Father, I pray that it was a help to people this morning who may be wondering what has been happening in their life. What is it that God is trying to tell me? What is it that God is wanting to accomplish in me? Lord, may they understand today You desire to use all of us. You desire to use each of us. But You will not be able to use us if we're not broken. Because pride goes for destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. You resist the proud. And so God, make us willing to be broken. That we may be tender-hearted, that we may not be offended, and that we may be used by You. Spirit of the living God, do that work in each one of Your children here today. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. The message was to believers this morning. If you're here today and you've never received Christ as your Savior, that's the very first thing you need to do. God can't use you until you belong to Him. And you belong to Him when you put your faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior. And I wonder how many people here this morning would say, Pastor, if I died this morning, I know for sure that I'd go to heaven. There's a time in my life when I have put my faith and trust in Jesus Christ as my Savior. And I'm trusting Him alone to take me to heaven one day. Pastor, here's my hand as a testimony. Will you slip it up that I may see it, Christian? Just hold it up. God bless you. You may put it down. Who's here today and would say, Pastor, I'm not sure If I died, I'd go to heaven. I don't know what would happen to me. Would you let me pray for you? Not embarrass you. I'll not call you out, but I'll remember you in prayer. Would you slip your hand up right now and just say, Pastor, pray for me this morning. I'm not sure about where I'd spend eternity. The message was to believers today. Wonder how many believers here today would say, Pastor, I see that maybe what I've been going through in my life and some of the struggles I'm having is the process of God breaking me. But I realize today God breaks before He uses. And it is a helpful thing for me that I'll take the breaking because I know God wants to use me. And Pastor, I'm going to ask the Spirit of God to help me, that God will break me, that He might use me. Pastor, God spoke to my heart this morning. Will you slip your hand up, Christian? Say, pray for me, Pastor. Yes. Amen. Amen. Hands across the auditorium. God bless you. You may put them down. In a moment, I'll pray and we'll have our invitation. If you are here this morning and you're not sure about your salvation, you're not sure about your eternity, in a moment I'll pray. When I'm done praying, we'll stand to our feet. When we stand to our feet, the pianist will play. Brother Bob will sing. Others will begin to come and pray at the altar. Slip out from your seat. Come down here to the front. I'll meet you. And we have people who have been trained. They'll take a Bible and they'll show you how you can know for sure that when you die, you'll go to heaven. Put your faith in Jesus Christ. If you're saved, you've never been baptized, you ought to come and say, Preacher, I need to be baptized. If you're saved and baptized and you believe this is the church you ought to belong to, and say, we just want to belong and serve and serve alongside the people here at Bible Baptist Church, we'd welcome you into the fellowship of our church. Christian, God's breaking that He might bless you and use you. Would you bow the knee to Him this morning and say, Lord, continue the process. I want to be used by You. I want to be near You. Then you have to have a broken heart. And God draws an eye to you. As the Spirit of God deals with your heart, obey Him this morning. Father, bless this invitation. Thank You for speaking to our hearts today. I pray Your will be done in every heart and life. I pray that no one will resist Your Holy Spirit this morning, but that each of us will do what He's bidding us to do. And may the Spirit of the living God fall fresh on us this morning. And I'll thank You for it. With your heads bowed, you stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, the pianist will play. As she plays the invitation, Brother Bob's going to sing. God has spoken to your heart. Respond to Him this morning. Will you please?
God never moves.
That's right.
Without purpose.
That's right.
Or plan. When trying His servant and molding a man, give thanks to the Lord. Though your testing seems long, in darkness He giveth a song. Oh, rejoice in the Lord, He makes no mistake. He knoweth the end of each path that I take. For when I am tried and purified, I shall come forth as gold. I could not see through the shadows ahead, so I looked at the cross of my Savior instead. I bow to the will of the Master that day. Then peace came and tears fled away. Oh, rejoice in the Lord, He makes no mistake. He knoweth the end of each path that I take. For when I am tried and purified, I shall come forth as gold. Now I can see testing comes from above. God strengthens His children and purges in love.
My Father knows best. I trust in His care. Through purging, more fruit I will bear. Oh, rejoice in the Lord. He makes no mistake. He knoweth the end of each path that I take. For when I am tried and purified, I shall come forth as gold.
Look this way for a minute. Most of you know that song and the story behind that song. That is written by Patch the Pirate. How many ever heard of Patch the Pirate? Most of you have. He has, for 30-some years, maybe longer, maybe coming up close to 40 years. He's produced children's, started with tapes and now then CDs and now DVDs and all sorts of music, because Ron Hamilton, they found a tumor on his eye. And he went into the Emory Hospital in Atlanta, not knowing if he'd come out of the surgery with his eye or without his eye. And as it is, he came out of the surgery without his eye. And, you know, you think, well, how can I serve God better with one eye than two eyes? That doesn't make any sense. Well, trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Lean not to thine own understanding. But God had a plan, and that's, while he was in the hospital recovering, he received just hundreds of cards. And in one of the cards was that verse from Job. I think it's 23:10, is it? Do you know? And when he hath tried me, I shall come forth as gold. And he penned the words to that song. He's just in church one night, and he had a patch over his eye still. And a little kid come up and said, "You look like a pirate." He said, "Well, I guess I do. I guess I'm Patch the Pirate." And that's how that ministry started. And then he began to write the songs for the children and such. Our kids grew up on him. And great, great ministry. But God broke before he used. That's the way he works. And so let's ask God to use us. But we have to be willing for God to break us. Amen? Let's pray together, shall we? Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness. Thank you for the truth of the Word of God. And thank you, God, for being a God that desires to use us. And we desire, Lord, to be used by God, that our life would bring honor and glory to you. When this life is over, we see you face to face. We would love to hear, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord." So, Father, take the truth today, and I pray it's been a help and encouragement to people this morning. Give us a good afternoon. Bring us back tonight for our services. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Amen. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. Brother Bob?
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood. Joined hands with Jesus as we travel this sod. For I'm a part of the family of God. Amen. You are dismissed. We'll see you tonight.